Myself, Shiva Prasad Damarla, a retired deputy general manager from BSNL and ex-senior project manager, AP State Fibernet Limited and ex-adjunct professor, EC department, PSMR College of Engineering and Technology, Vijayawada, AP. In this session, we will discuss about one of the subsystems of telephone networks. So that is about subscriber loop systems. This is the part one in series. Telecom networks, an introduction. Public switch telephone network, that is PSTN, or the plain old telephone system ports, or the landline network, is the most stupendous telecommunication network. So it is an amazing and extensive network. The length of the telephone wire pipes buried underground is in the order of billions of kilometers. The copper wires generally laid underground for providing telephone networks is in the order of billions of kilometers world over. A unique feature of telecom network or telephone network is that every piece of equipment, telephone, or procedure which has evolved over the past 100 years is capable of working with each other. That means they are compatible with each other. So the telecom network has evolved over the past 100 years. So the beauty of the telephone network is that each and every piece of the equipment, telephone, or the procedures, they are compatible with each other. The enormous complexity of the telephone network is managed by using a hierarchical structure by worldwide standardization and decentralization of administration, operation, and maintenance. So this complex telephone network is managed by a systematic structure by the worldwide standardization organization like ITU, International Telecom Union, and also by decentralizing the network activities like administration, operation, and maintenance. Now, in this slide, we will look into the various subsystems of telecom networks. The telecom network can be viewed as consisting of the following major subsystems. So the following are the major subsystems pertaining to telecom networks. Number one, subscriber end instruments or equipments. This is one subsystem. Another subsystem is subscriber loop systems. The other subsystem is switching systems. How a switch works. Then the transmission systems. The fourth subsystem, vital subsystem, is transmission systems. So they interconnect various telephone exchanges or various network elements within the telecom network. Then the fifth important subsystem is pertaining to the signaling between, say for example, between the calling and the called party. How you are able to dial or connect to any person anywhere in the world. So two persons, that is calling and called parties, can be connected wherever they are located in the world. So that is about signaling systems. Now let us discuss about the one of the subsystems, that is subscriber loop systems. Every subscriber in a telephone network is generally connected to the nearest switching office, rather to say the telephone exchange, by means of a dedicated pair of wires. Subscriber loop refers to this pair of wires connecting the telephone user to the switch. So every telephone user or telephone is connected to the nearest switching office, that is the telephone exchange, by means of a dedicated pair of wires. So each and every user will have his own pair of wires, two wires, through underground cables in general. So the term subscriber loop refers to the pair of wires connecting the telephone user to the switch. So what we are going to discuss in this subsystem is about the telephone wires that are connecting the subscriber or the telephone user with its telephone exchange. So this is what we are going to discuss in this session. It is impracticable to run physically independent pairs from every subscriber premises to the exchange. So let us consider a telephone exchange of medium size of 5,000 lines. So you cannot run from telephone exchange to each and every user or to each and every 5,000 users separate a pair of wires. So it is impracticable. So we adopt a systematic method wherein finally or ultimately you will be able to provide one pair of wires to each and every subscriber and connected to the telephone switch. So that is how it is arranged in a systematic manner we are going to discuss. It is far easier to lay cables containing a number of pairs for different geographical locations and run individual pairs to the subscriber premises. The systematic approach what we adopt is with reference to the telephone exchange, from the telephone exchange to different geographical important locations in that town or city, we lay high capacity cables. And from different important geographic locations, further we lay the small capacity cables, and finally we run one pair of wires to the user end, to the subscriber premises. So that is how it is connected. So different sizes of the cables we use for different geographical locations, and ultimately we provide a pair of wires between the telephone user and the telephone exchange. So here one systematic method how the subscriber loop or the a pair of wires are provided in a hierarchical setup is shown in the drawing, and we will go through the contents step by step. Generally, four levels of cabling are used as shown in the diagram. So four levels of cabling, indirectly four levels of cable capacities are used for ultimately providing one pair of wires to a telephone user. First level, high capacity main feeder, that is MF cables, are laid from the exchange MDF, which stands for main distribution frame, to different important geographical locations, and the main feeder cables are terminated on feeder points. Okay, so we designate by FP. But however, in telecom industry, these feeder points are known as cabinets. Let us see in the drawing. This is the MDF. Other side, left side, is the telephone switch in the exchange. This is one main distribution frame which is available in the telephone exchange. So the wires coming from the switch are terminated on MDF one side. So let us assume on the left side. On the right side, you have the cable network, which ultimately provides a pair of wires to its subscriber. So the cable between the MDF and this feeder point, this high capacity cable, is known as main feeder cable, MF cable. So that's why here, to indicate that it is very the highest capacity cable, so they have shown the drawing with four lines. This is the first termination point. This is one vital geographical location where this feeder point is terminated, is established. Okay. In the next level, branch feeder cables are laid to different areas and are terminated on sub-feeder points, FP. They are also called feeder points only. So technically speaking, further, they are distributed to some other interior geographical locations. They are known as feeder points. In industry, we say their locations as pillar. It's a pillar point where the branch feeder cables are terminated. This is second level. So here you can see from the main feeder point to sub-feeder point, we have branch feeder cables. Here, if you can see, these branch feeder cables are represented by three lines. So that means their capacity is lesser when compared to the main feeder cables. So it is a tapering arrangement. As you go on in the distribution, the number of cable pairs in the cable will be of lesser size. In the third level, distribution cables are laid from the subscriber feeder points, that is FP, that is pillar in the industry, to the distribution points. They are known as DPs in the lanes. They are in the lanes, small roads. Here you can see from the branch feeder points. So these are the distribution cables. These are the distribution cables. We have indicated with two wires. So here indirectly we are indicating that these cables capacity wise, the number of pairs, cable pairs in these distribution cables are less when compared to branch feeder cables. These are all the distribution cables, and the cable is terminated on what is known as distribution point. Distribution point, distribution point, like this. On this distribution cable, so for easy understanding, they have shown some four distribution points. Here another four, here another four. Then in the fourth level, drop wires are extended from DPs to the subscriber premises and terminated on line jack unit on a wall. So from the distribution point, as you can see here in this here, from the distribution point, so drop wire means it is a pair of wire, a small strip of cable laid from the distribution point to the subscriber premises. So that cable is known as drop wire. It consists of two wires. It is something like in a strip form. Okay, this is drop wire. This is terminated on the line jack unit, which is mounted generally on a wall in the subscriber premises, in some room or hall, wherever they require the telephone instrument. The drop wire consists of two copper conductors, as already I have told. Telephone instrument is connected to line jack unit with the help of RJ11 cable wire. So after terminating the drop wire on line jack unit, which we can see in the subsequent slides, so we connect the telephone instrument to line jack unit. That means two wires from the exchange MDF via main feeder point, branch feeder point, and distribution point, they are connected to the telephone user. Further, we will look into the subscriber loop systems. Main feeder cables are of higher capacity than branch feeder cables. Similarly, branch feeder cables are of higher capacity when compared to distribution cables. That's what we have discussed. These main feeder cables are of higher capacity. This service branch feeder cables, which we are indicating with three wires. Here we are indicating with four wires. Okay. The main feeder cables are of higher capacity and they are in the range of, say for example, from, it can be anything depending upon the exchange and its capacity, or the town or the village or the city. It may range anything in between 100 to 2000 pairs. This is about this main feeder cable. Then about branch feeder cables are of medium capacity. They are in the range of 100 to 1000 pairs. So you will have, so this branch feeder cables, their capacity may range anything in between 100 to 1000 pairs. 1000 pairs means, with this branch feeder cable, you are able to, from this point, you will be able to provide connections up to a maximum of 1000 telephone connections. Then coming to the distribution cable. The distribution cables are of lesser capacity and they are in the range of 10 to 500 pairs. When compared to branch feeder cables, the distribution cables, here they have shown in the drawing, DC, distribution cables. These cables are of smaller capacity. So they may range, the capacity may range up to 500 pairs, 10 to 500 pairs. That means through one distribution cable, so with so many distribution points, a maximum of 500 pairs or 500 telephone connections can be provided. Suppose this, whatever we are discussing, the higher capacities, they are mainly for important or bigger cities. In smaller places, it may be a 10 pair, 20 pair, 100 pair, 50 pair, 100 pair, 200 pair, something like that. As far as the main distribution frame is concerned, about this, on one side, two wires from switch pertaining to each customer are terminated. If you see on the MDF, so switch, we assume it is on the left side. Both switch and MDF are located in the telephone exchange itself. For each and every subscriber from Sitch, you will get two wires. They are terminated on one side of the MDF. Okay? And the other side of MDF, a cable pair from each subscriber is terminated. From the other side, on the right side for easy convenience, as depicted in the diagram. So from each subscriber, via line jack, drop wire, distribution point, and subfeeder point, and main feeder point, then to main feeder cable, it reaches the MDF. It is terminated on right side, let us assume. The cross jumpering on MDF between the switch side and line side facilitates a telephone connection to a subscriber. So if you see on the right side, so the subscriber instruments or telephones are connected via all these cables. On the other side, the wires, a pair of wires pertaining to each and every user emanating from the telecom switch are terminated on the left side. So you can provide a cross connection between the two wires of the switch and the two wires of the subscriber coming through different levels of the cables are interconnected, and the telephone in your premises will be functioning using the interconnection provided MDF. So MDF is the isolating point between the electronic switch and the outdoor cable network. So here I have depicted a practical industry aspect cable network diagram. So layout of the wired telephone network industry aspects. Let us go through the contents and we will also look into the drawing provided here. The adjacent drawing indicates the cabling arrangement from the industry aspects, industry view. Though four level cabling was adopted in major cities, when the landline communication was in peak, in the recent past, the industry has adopted to three level. So, as earlier we have studied, four levels of cabling was there when the landline communication was in its peak. Consequent to the advent of mobile communication, and most of the subscribers are adopting to mobile communication, and the demand for the landline communication has substantially decreased. Now, instead of four levels, or in the earlier stage also, when it was in peak also for small towns, they used to adopt three level of cabling network. So that is what we will study here. So this is the exchange. Okay, let us not worry about this side because we are discussing about the subscriber loop. So the output from the exchange is connected to MDF, main distribution frame. Okay, that is one side. From main distribution frame, the cables, the feeder cables, here in industry generally we say primary cable. The main feeder cable or the branch feeder cable is known as primary cable. This is one primary cable connecting to this pillar, that is branch feeder. Or now there is no question of branch feeder or main feeder, it is simply pillar. So it is pillar, another pillar. This is another primary cable connecting to this pillar. From this pillar, you can here some three DPs are depicted here, 3, 4. So this is one DP, this is one DP, this is one DP, distribution point. That means from this pillar, we have laid a 10 pair or 20 pair cable to the distribution point in a lane or sublane. So here another side, another distribution point. From this distribution point, so you will have drop wires. These are the, this is one drop wire, this is one drop wire, this is one drop. As per this diagram, from this DP, three telephone connections are provided in three different houses or offices or whatever it is. So as we already discussed, the drop wire from the distribution point goes to the subscriber premises. You may be a residential user, office user, or an institute like, or some other organization. So it is terminated on line jack units. The output of the line jack units or other side of the line jack unit is connected to telephone instrument with the help of what is known as RJ11 cable. So here three levels what we adopt in the industry at present are three stages: MDF to pillar. This is MDF to pillar. This is high capacity primary cable. This cable is known as primary cable. Then pillar to distribution point, small capacity distribution cable. And these are the distribution cables to DP. DP to subscriber, drop wire. So from DP to the subscriber, line jack unit, we have what is known as drop wire. As already I have told, drop wire is nothing but a strip of two wires terminated on line jack units, from which, from the line jack units, the telephone instrument is connected with the help of RJ11 cable. Here I am trying to show you some of the photos I have taken in the field. So what are the different components or the elements which we have discussed so far, how they look? So the pillar looks like this. One side you get your primary cable, other side you will have distribution cable. These are the, they are known as tag blocks on which the cable pairs are terminated. One side, if you consider this left side as the primary cable, the right side is the distribution cable. So whenever a telephone connection is required, so they interconnect between these two. So the distribution point looks like this. So below you can see underground cable is terminated of low capacity, maybe 5 pair, 10 pair or 20 pair. Generally, they are terminated on distribution point. From distribution point, the RJ, the drop wire is extended to the customer premises. So this is the drop wire you can see here. So the drop wire looks like this. This is the magnified view of drop wire, which consists of two copper wires like a strip. Then this wire from the DP, which is run from DP, the drop wire which is run from the distribution point, is terminated on LJ unit, which was installed on generally on the wall of the customer or the subscriber or the user, telephone user. From this female socket, with the help of RJ11 cable, the connector looks like this. So this is the RJ11 cable. One end is plugged into this, the other end is plugged into the telephone instrument, which will also have a female socket like this. So then the telephone instrument is connected. So this RJ11 will also have this RJ11 cable, which is connected to line jack unit, which is connected to drop wire, which is connected to distribution points, DP. From DP it goes to pillar, from pillar it goes to MDF, from MDF it goes to the switch. That means the telephone instrument here is connected to the telephone exchange for making calls. Further, we will discuss about the subscriber loop systems, having seen the industry aspects in view of the industry. Now we will study something like a theoretical aspect as well as the industry aspects. The feeder cables are terminated on the, that is main feeder cables are terminated on the main distribution frame. So already we have seen it is something like repetition at the exchange. MDF is located within the exchange. The subscriber cable pairs emanating from the exchange are also terminated on the MDF. So here, suppose you assume exchange is there on the left side, they are connected on the MDF. Two wires for each customer. Subscriber pairs from the user side and the subscriber pairs from the exchange side are interconnected at the MDF by means of jumpers. So these are the subscriber pairs coming via DP's sub-feeder point, or let us say DP to pillar, from pillar to main distribution cable via the main feeder point or cabinets. So nowadays we are not using the cabinets. Straight away we are terminating on the main feeder cable is terminated on the feeder point, which is known as pillar. This side one pillar. Forget for some time, you forget about this. From here, one main cable, primary cable is laid to this pillar, another to this pillar, as we have seen in the earlier drawing. So here MDF, so two wires are coming from the user like this, and two wires are coming from the exchange onto MDF. Both are interconnected by means of what is known as jumpers. That means two wires are connected. One is the exchange side, the other is the user side. User side is through cable, exchange side is through two wires from the switch. The MDF thus provides a flexible interconnection between the exchange and subscriber lines coming through the feeder points. This provides a flexible point for interconnecting the subscriber pairs that are emanating from the switch and other pairs coming from the cable network from the user side. So this is some more information about the subscriber loop systems. Now let us look into the limiting factors on subscriber loop systems. Here what we will try to understand is there is a limitation at which a telephone connection can be provided with reference to telephone switch or the exchange. So what I mean to say, you cannot provide a telephone connection which is some 10 to 12 kilometers with reference to the telephone exchange geographical location. Why it is not possible? What are the limiting factors for the maximum distance at which a telephone connection can be provided? All these aspects we will try to understand in this slide and the subsequent slides. For economy, that is as far as the cost consideration is concerned, it is desirable that the subscriber loop lengths are as large as possible so that a single exchange can serve a larger area, but there are two factors that limit their length. So, as a telecom service provider, he prefers to have less number of telephone exchanges, and each telephone exchange he prefers to cover more geographical area. But there is a limit for the distance at which the telephone connection can be provided. These are the limiting factors. What are the limiting factors that govern the distance between the user and the telephone switch? There are two important limiting factors. One limiting factor pertains to signaling limits. So signaling plays a vital role in communication. So that plays a major role about the farthest distance at which you can provide a telephone connection with reference to the switch. The other one is the attenuation limits, that is the signal loss. So more the distance the user is located, more the signal loss, and the speech may not be audible and the quality may deteriorate. We will try to understand one after the other about these limiting factors. First, let us go through about the signaling limits. Signaling is used for subscriber lines, for example, off hook signal and dial pulses. So from the subscriber, the signaling is required between the subscriber and the telephone exchange. For example, the subscriber intends to make a call. So first, what he has to do? He has to lift his telephone. That is known as off hook. That means a loop is to be extended to the switch. Then only the user gets the dial tone and he can dial the number. That means exchange should get the indication that a particular subscriber intends to make use of his telephone connection. And also the dial pulses. So whatever the pulses he is dialing, accordingly the correct pulses to be sent up to the telephone exchange from the user point, then only you will be connected to the correct number. Suppose somebody wants to dial my number 2424 9959. So if the subscriber is within the reasonable distance, whatever he dials 2499959, the same pulses will be transmitted, 2 followed by 4 followed by 999 followed by 59, exactly. And accordingly the switch sends a ring to 2499959. Suppose if the user is far away and the pulses are not accurately sent, he will be connected to a wrong number or the number to which he is not intending to speak. So it causes annoyance to the subscriber. So he has to make another attempt. A certain minimum current is required to perform these signaling functions properly, and exchanges must be designed to deliver such current. So for the telephone signaling or the telephone instruments or the telephone connection to function properly, so minimum signaling current is required for the user. So accordingly, the exchanges are designed and the customers are provided the connections. Exchanges are designed to accept a maximum loop resistance of 1300 ohms. So the loop resistance should be within 1300 ohms. So this stipulates the maximum distance at which it can be provided. Suppose in special circumstances, in rare conditions, if you want to provide at a far away places, so what is the solution? One solution is installing another exchange. So with the existing exchange, how it is possible? In special circumstances, with the help of additional line equipment, you have to provide certain additional line equipments to drive up to 2400 ohms. By providing some additional line equipments, so it is possible to work even up to 2400 ohms. That means you can increase the distance at which a telephone can instrument or the telephone connection can work. For that, you do require additional line equipment. So even then, there are certain difficulties to work up to 2400. So with additional equipment, it is theoretically possible to provide connection with a loop resistance of 2400 ohms. Then we will further discuss about the signaling limits with reference to the driving current or bias currents. The microphone in the subscriber set requires 25 milliamps as the bias current for its proper function. The telephone instrument will have one transmitter, one receiver. That is, your microphone is your transmitter. It has to function properly. For its appropriate and proper functioning, it requires about 25 milliamps bias current for its functioning. Therefore, this condition, that is about this bias condition of 25 milliamps, also puts a limit on the total loop resistance. So that what we have seen in the earlier slide. So you have to ensure that about 25 milliamps bias current is to be provided. Accordingly, the resistance or the loop resistance is to be taken care of. So you cannot exceed a certain limit, and you cannot obtain 25 milliamps bias current for its proper working. The DC loop resistance or DC of copper conductor is given by the equation. So here there is one equation which stipulates the RDC, that is the DC resistance of the conductor is given by 21.96 upon D square ohms per kilometer. D is the diameter of the conductor in millimeter. If D is the diameter in millimeter, so the resistance, DC resistance of the conductor is given by this formula, 21.96 by D square ohms per kilometer. This is the per kilometer resistance of the conductor, which is inversely proportional to the diameter. As the diameter increases, the resistance decreases and the bias current increases. Subscriber instruments are usually connected to the exchanges by using copper conductors of sizes ranging from AWG 19 to AWG 26. So the gauge of the conductor, the gauge always refers to the inverse of the diameter. So the gauges may be in the range of AWG 19 to AWG 26. AWG means American Wire Gauge 19. So when you compare this 19 and 26 AWG, AWG 19 means it is of higher dia cable, which offers less resistance. The wire dia is more, so it gives less resistance. It provides more bias current. AWG means smaller dia wire, so it offers more resistance, so less bias current. However, generally, the cables used are in the range of 19 to 26. Smaller gauge wires represent thicker conductors, as I said, and offer less DC resistance per unit length. They are used to connect the subscribers located at faraway distances and are more expensive. So we use low gauge conductors or the wire, copper wire, so that it provides less resistance because the diameter is more. But the problem is, as the diameter of the copper cable increases, as the copper quantity increases, since copper is a costly metal, so it is, the cable is more expensive, the wire is more expensive. So as far as cost is concerned, we prefer higher gauge. Higher gauge means low diameter, higher resistance. But it should drive the signal properly. So here one table is given from which we can better understand the relationship between the gauge diameter and the resistance per kilometer and the signaling attenuation per kilometer. So the higher gauge, as we have already discussed, is 19. So low gauge means higher dia. The dia is 0.91 millimeter. The resistance of the wire per kilometer is 27.3 ohms per kilometer. And the attenuation what it offers per kilometer is 0.71 dB. Like this, for 22 gauge, it is of lesser dia when compared to this, it is 0.64. And the resistance is almost double, 54.7, and the attenuation also increases to 1.01. In case of AWG24, the diameter is still less when compared to this, and the resistance is more, and the attenuation also more. Here, the AWG26, that is the lesser dia cable, which generally they use in telecom network. Subject to the condition, the telephone connection is not very much far away. So the diameter is only 0.41 and the resistance is up to 1.138 ohms per kilometer. So here it is drastically increased. It is so in case of attenuation also has increased up to 1.61 dB decibels per kilometer. We will further try to understand this concept of the gauge diameter and the loop resistance, the interlink between the bias current and all these aspects with one example. Let us assume an exchange uses minus 40 volts battery to drive the subscriber lines. So here the exchange works on minus 40 volts. Of course, in the field, generally it works on minus 48 volts. For example, for easy calculations, they have taken one example with minus 40 volts. A resistance of 250 ohms is placed in series with the battery to protect it from the short circuit. So the exchange works on minus 40 volts. So one end of this 40 volts, it is connected to 250 ohms series resistance to avoid any inadvertent short circuits between the two wires. So there is no resistance in between. So both these wires are short circuited and causes damage. So to avoid short circuit, we provide 250 ohms approximately as the series resistance. The standard subscriber telephone offers a DC resistance of 50 ohms. So this is the wire connecting, this is the cable wire. So this is the telephone. The telephone will have its own internal resistance. It is generally in the order of 50 ohms. The microphone requires 23 milliamps for its proper function. Now let us determine the farthest distance from the exchange at which a subscriber can be located if 26 AWG conductor is used. So here in this network, we are using the lower diameter cable, which is of 26 AWG. So at what distance telephone connection can be provided? What is the maximum distance between exchange and this telephone connection? So under these given conditions of minus 40 volts exchange voltage and 250 ohms series resistance and internal resistance of 50 ohms and the wire used from the exchange to the subscriber is of 26 AWG. Now let us calculate the distance between the maximum possible distance between exchange and the user. Let the RL is the loop line loop resistance. Then we have an equation like this. 23 milliamps, 23 into 10 to the power of minus 3 is equal to the feeding current is 40 volts divided by 250 ohms, that is a series resistance, and the internal resistance 50 ohms plus RL is the resistance of the wire, RL, the resistance of the wire of both the limbs put together is RL. So hence RL, if you calculate from this, it comes to 1439 ohms. So it can tolerate a loop resistance of 1439 ohms under these given circumstances. Okay. From the earlier table, for 26 AWG wire, so what will be the loop length or the wire length? So you have 1439 is the loop resistance, and the per kilometer resistance is 138. Once we will go back and see. See, from here you can see the DC resistance per kilometer is 138. So if you divide the loop resistance by the per kilometer resistance, you will get the loop length as 10.42 kilometers. The loop length, what I mean to say is from exchange to the user and the user to the exchange. This is the loop resistance. Then what would be the distance? Distance will be 50% of it, because the loop length 10.42 refers to go and return distance, that is 10.42 kilometers. So therefore, in this condition, I can provide this telephone connection at 10.42 by 2, that is 5.21 kilometers. That is maximum, up to say roughly 5 kilometers, it can work. Okay, this is about the loop resistance and the interrelation between the working voltage and the gauge of the wire. So this much we will discuss in this first part, and we will continue our discussion in the next part about the other limiting factors. Only there are two main limiting factors. One is the signaling limits, what we have discussed with reference to DC resistance, and in the next session we will discuss about the attenuation limits, the signal loss, and the distance up to which it can work. What are the different parameters that we have to consider? We will discuss in the next session. Thank you. Thank you very much for participating in this session.